In this video, we're solving a static equilibrium problem where we have a horizontal beam suspended from two vertical strings, but these are not arranged symmetrically. One of the strings is closer to the center than the other. And we're given a lot of specs on the situation here. The mass of this beam is 177 kilograms. The first string with a tension of T1 is connected 90 centimeters from the left end. The second string with a tension of T2 is connected 30 centimeters from the right end. The total length of the beam is 3 meters. And of course, the natural question here is, what's the tension in each of these two strings? But the problem is broken into three parts. Parts A and B, we're going to get the tensions T1 and T2. And then in part C, we're going to use a force analysis to verify that our answer is correct. Now, before we get started, it's useful to label the center of mass of this beam. So I'll just put it right there. And then we need to figure out the distances between that center of mass and each of the attachment points of these strings. So because the beam is uniform, the center of mass is just the geometric center of the beam. That's the 1.5 meter mark. And if I look at the distance between the string T1 and the center of mass, well, it's attached 90 centimeters from the left end, or 0.9 meters. The center of mass is at the 1.5 meter mark. This means the distance between the string and the center of mass is 0.6 meters. And I take a similar approach with T2. That's connected 30 centimeters, or 0.3 meters from the right end, which means the distance between the center of mass and the attachment of that string is 1.2 meters. And now before we start our analysis, we'll just throw in all the force vectors, remembering that gravity acts at the center of mass of this rigid body. So there's the force of gravity attached to the center of mass, and that's given by mg. And then we have the tensions in these two strings, T1 and T2, pulling upward. So in part A, we're asked to use a torque analysis to find the tension in the left cable, T1. And the key to this is to choose a rotation axis wisely. What we're going to do is analyze the torques about the attachment point of the string T2. So we're going to say if this object is in static equilibrium, then all the clockwise torques better add up to the same thing as all the counterclockwise torques. And with respect to that rotation axis, I can see that gravity is trying to rotate the beam in the counterclockwise direction, and T1 is trying to rotate the beam in the clockwise direction. Each of those torques is given by the perpendicular force multiplied by the length of the lever arm with respect to our rotation axis. So our clockwise torque is given by T1 multiplied by the length of the lever arm, which is 1.8 meters here. It's 0.6 plus the 1.2. While the counterclockwise torque is given by the force of gravity mg, which is located at a distance of 1.2 meters from our chosen rotation axis. Now we can throw in numbers for m and g. That's 177 kilograms times 9.8 meters per second squared. And there's our 1.2. And I can see that all I have to do is divide by 1.8 to solve for T1. And when I run the numbers on this, I get about 1,156 newtons. In part B, we're asked to just do the same thing to find T2. So we use a torque analysis to get T2. For this analysis, our rotation axis should be the attachment point of T1. And again, the whole point of that is that T1 will not appear in the torque analysis because the lever arm is zero with respect to that rotation axis. So we start analyzing torques about rotation axis one. Again, the clockwise torques better balance the counterclockwise torques for this object to stay in equilibrium. And with respect to this new rotation axis, it looks like gravity is trying to twist the beam in the clockwise direction. So if I look at the size of that torque, that's mg multiplied by 0.6. The distance between that attachment point of the vector mg and the rotation axis at T1. Now it's T2 that's exerting a counterclockwise torque here, so I have T2 multiplied by the distance between its attachment point and our rotation axis, which is 1.8 meters. And again, we can throw in the numbers for m and g. I have 177 kilograms, 9.8 meters per second squared, a lever arm of 0.6 meters. On the right-hand side, T2 times 1.8. And I simply multiply the numbers on the left and divide by 1.8. And this gives me roughly 578 newtons. Finally, in part C, we're asked to verify our answers by using a force analysis in the y direction. So what we're looking for here is that the net force in the y direction must be zero. And this gives us a convenient way to check our work. So we'll use the standard sign convention and call all the upward forces positive, the downward forces negative, and see if they add up to zero. Symbolically, we're asking if I take T1 plus T2, those are both in the positive direction, minus mg, do I actually end up with zero? So we plug the numbers in, and for T1, I had 1,156 newtons, keeping in mind this was rounded a little bit. And for T2, also rounded a little bit, 578 newtons. M, the mass of the beam, was 177 kilograms, and then G, 9.8 meters per second squared, which itself is rounded a little bit. When I run the numbers on this, I get negative 0.6 newtons. And notice that this number is a couple orders of magnitude less than the tensions themselves. In other words, I can understand it as a result of rounding error, and I can say this is approximately equal to zero, verifying that our tensions were computed correctly in the first two parts of the problem. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.